So, implicit group knowledge. Actually, you might have found out I expanded a lot on this, and I'm going to expand a lot on this. And there's a good reason, because techniques for here and techniques for here, in a way, help you to cover most. There's not so much stuff that is just only in documents, and there's not too much stuff in many cases that is just only intuitive expert behavior. A lot of things people can talk about, and a lot of things are culture or community of practice. So, community of practice is. Now, if you are going to analyze this one and we are really using the ethnographic approach, we should not have a conceptual framework. Richard John is very clear about it. A real ethnographer doesn't know what to expect. Consequently, if you need to send an ethnographer to some domain, to some situation to analyze, find somebody who doesn't know the situation at all. Somebody who really is completely blank about it. Otherwise, people will understand and interpret immediately. Right? And this doesn't help at all. So, no a priori concept means you have to hang around and identify relevant concepts. Machtelt Hoeven, my student who did the analysis in the Amsterdam office, office, she had a plan, and her plan was for 1 month to hang around. Which means she first had to make herself accepted, and once she was allowed to be in, she was there for a month, just walking around, being able to sit in the office, being able to attend discussions, to attend meetings, to look at stuff, just being there, and being accepted, and being considered part of the furniture. Right? So this is, and then you need to have informal representations of what you found. So write down in your diary, literally, right? Make pictures, right? A journalist type record. And with the goal to understand the complexity of multiple activities, multiple actors, multiple agendas in the natural group. So go to where the action is and try to understand the actions in total, which is all the time complex. So without focusing on things, because as soon as you focus, you don't see other things or you take them for granted. Right? So you focus on the situation. You are not focusing on what individual people know. So knowledge and meaning are part of the community, and they are developed in the community. And knowledge, in a way, is ability to participate meaningfully. It's completely different from what a cognitive psychologist would say. A cognitive psychologist would say, knowledge is here. It's in long-term memory. Ethnographers say, I don't understand what long-term memory means, but knowledge means the way we understand how to behave together. Right? It's a completely different concept. And knowledge is, people develop this knowledge together. And part of this knowledge, consequently, is implicit. It's, we all do it this way, and we are not aware there could be another way. And you only find out if you are going to be in a completely different culture. The first time I was teaching in China, this was kind of a culture shock for me, because people had a completely different way of working together, a different way of considering the relation between the teacher and the student, and so on, and a different focus on what it meant to do a course. In China, I don't give marks. In China, I never give an assessment of work in terms of good or bad. And at the end of a course, we say, okay, we did the course. And it's, as a teacher, my responsibility to make sure everybody gets all the experiences and has to try it. And the students are at a level that they will succeed in that case. And in Italy, the only thing that happens in my course, in the Faculty of Architecture, this is not computer science, the only thing happens is that about 10% of the students halfway the course withdraw. And students who don't withdraw, they finish the course and they smile and they have a nice portfolio. And in Amsterdam, students want to have a mark. And if you know the Dutch marking system, some students in Amsterdam say, oh, I got a 7, I did too much work. You see, so this is completely different cultures. The meaning of assessment, the meaning of participating in a course really could be very much different. Okay, good. So, and everything is situated. It's situated tasks, situated actions, situated understanding. I understand certain behavior in the classroom. I understand certain behavior in the shop. Right? And somewhere else it would have a different meaning or what would be inappropriate sometimes. So, ethnography is field work. You have to go there. Some of you have to go to Twente tomorrow if we choose to have this this client to participate. It's a nice client with a good job. Ethnographer is a participant observer, meaning that you are part of the situation. Machtel Hoeven spent a month to be accepted in the offices and to be accepted even to be at intake meetings with clients. Right? And to completely be allowed to watch what's going on. So you have to be part of the situation, and so if possible you should be an apprentice or a legitimate peripheral participant. Bridget Jordan, her last job, as far as I know, was analyzing or doing a task model for air traffic control systems. But one of her first jobs was to look at the transfer of medical knowledge in primitive societies like an Indian tribe in Mexico. And in that tribe, she was allowed to be an apprentice midwife. So she was focusing on supporting women to give birth to children. And there was an official midwife, an Italian woman, using the Italian type of techniques, and she was allowed to be an apprentice to work. Right? So, and this is how an ethnographer can do it. Okay, and it's accepted that you ask questions. In ethnography, you can still ask questions, but not like the Suzanne Sabillon or Gressel method that I showed you before. Asking questions in ethnography means if something happens, you could ask, why did you do it? Or you did it so quickly, how did you do it? Right? So triggered by an actual situation, you can ask questions. Otherwise, don't ask questions, just write down. And by the way, this means in ethnography that to start with, if you are really a good ethnographer, you don't know anything. So you just find out things that are funny or strange. Don't try to wait till you understand. Write it in your diary immediately. And then, after a day, or after a week, or after a month, you start to understand. But if you wait to write down until you understand, you won't write down, because it's business as usual. There's nothing to write down. Right? So ask the moment you are surprised. Okay, so 2 points of view in another fit, the view of the analyst. I always say I need two different glasses. So the analyst is the one who is being surprised, who is recording things that are completely new. At the same time, you try to get the view of the aboriginal, to understand the situation from the point of view of the people that live there. So these are two different glasses, two different ways to look at the same phenomenon. One is, oops, this is new. They never do this in my country. And the other is, I understand, I've been here long enough, I understand why you are doing this. Okay, so this means you really need the diary from day one. And don't wait till you understand, because you lost it. Methods, hanging around, which is identifying the basic situational phenomena and getting accepted. Informal questions triggered by activities. Observation of routine and expert behavior and analyzing the interactions. These are, let me say, steps in a way and different ways of doing ethnography. All of this is also on the website that you are being provided. So, and then there's orientation, because you should focus at a certain moment. Maybe not at day one, not at the first moment, but at a certain moment you have to make a choice. And there are four ways to focus. There's what we call the person-oriented record. You could look at the daily activities and interactions of a person, maybe somebody taking a role. Right. So try to find out what's happening if somebody takes a specific role. We call this, Bridget Jordan called this person-oriented, but my interpretation is focus on the role. You could do object-oriented, focus a certain thing, focus a form that's traveling between in and out boxes in an office. Or focus what happens with a story that's told by somebody who tells it to another and expands it and so on, right? Or setting-oriented, look at everything that's going on at this location, in the coffee room, in the operating theater, in the classroom. So but focus at a certain location, maybe physical location. And then there's task or process-oriented. You could say, I focus on the process. Four different orientations. It's impossible to take all four of them. So depending on your case, on what you are finding out is more relevant, focus on one or two. It always makes sense to say my main focus will be on people taking that role. Or my main focus will be to find out what happens with the force. Or my main focus will be to find out what happens with the process of getting unemployment money. Or my main focus to find out what's going on in the nurse's coffee room in the hospital. Right? Well, look at spatial organization. What does it mean that somebody has its own location to sit, right? Here we have a well-arranged room, and it's when I enter the room, if that would be my first time, I still wouldn't know where to stand, right? The room, it's very clear who should be the teacher, and in other cases, could be completely different, right? So tomorrow, you will find me sitting over there, and one of you is standing, right? And this means now you are sharing the presentation. Okay, so is it fixed or is it rearranged? Do people have a fixed seating in the room? Maybe you have, you haven't.
Yeah.
I could find out in a couple of days, but I know already.
Yeah,
okay, good. So nobody should sit here, it's clear, right? So this is fine. And in some cases, people voluntarily change, right? If I'm at a lecture, depending on whether I intend to ask tough questions, I will choose my location, right? Because I know. Okay, good. So artifacts. So what happens with artifacts? Where will they be? Like, construction and revision of documents. Who owns things, right? Is this my coffee cup? Somebody brought it to me this morning. Was this his personal cup, or is this a cup that is for visitors? Do you all have your own cup? I think you have your own cup, no?
I have my own cup, yeah.
Yeah, it looks like one, right? How can I know? You see, so this kind of thing, it's like symbolic meaning. Is it a dress code, like in a hospital, a white coat and a stethoscope tells me this is a doctor, right? Even I think if I'm a burglar, it works. And non-physical objects like passwords and jokes. I wouldn't like somebody else to make my joke when I'm there at the coffee room, right? So, good. I never know when this will